Good morning. If you'll join me for the announcements located on the back of the bulletin, we have a nice prayer list. If you'll please look over those, our shut-ins, Doris and Tommy, don't forget the military. Birthdays this week, Taylor on the 14th and Jill McMillan on the 15th. We also have a Feeding Jesus ministry that's putting together a cookbook. We have deadlines in November. Please contact Taylor if you have any questions. Roadside Pantry could still use some more pop tops. I noticed the other day after the storm, it was standing wide open and empty. So if we could contribute to that, that would be wonderful. This week we have the Men's Emmaus Thursday at 6:30. And there's always Feeding Jesus on Saturday at 9 a.m. if you would like to assist. If we could go ahead and sing the birthday song in honor of Taylor, Jill, and anyone else who may have a birthday this week. If we could all stand for the call to worship, Psalm 138, found in the hymnal on page 853-54. I give you thanks, O Lord, with my whole heart. Before the gods, I sing your praise.
I bow down towards your holy temple and give thanks to your name for your steadfast love and faithfulness.
For you have exalted your name and your word above everything.
On the day I called, you answered me. You strengthened my life.
All the rulers of the earth shall praise you, O Lord.
They have heard the words of your mouth.
And they shall sing of the ways of the Lord.
For great is the glory of the Lord.
For the Lord is high, but regards the lowly. Though I walk in the midst of trouble, you preserve my life.
You stretch out your hand against the wrath of my enemies, and your right hand delivers me.
O Lord, fulfill your purpose for me. O Lord, may your steadfast love endure forever. Do not forsake the work of your hands. Our hymn of praise is on page 591, Rescue the Perishing.
Thank you.
If you'll join me for the affirmation of faith, the Apostles' Creed, found on page 881. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. You may be seated. Today's Old Testament scripture comes from 2 Samuel 18, verses 5 through 9. And the king ordered Joab and Abishai and Attai, deal gently for my sake with the young man Absalom. And all the people heard when the king gave orders to all the commanders about Absalom. So the army went out into the field against Israel, and the battle was fought in the forest of Ephraim. And the men of Israel were defeated there by the servants of David, and the slaughter there was great on that day, 20,000 men. The battle spread over the face of the country, and the forest devoured more people that day than the sword. And Absalom chanced to meet the servants of David. Absalom was riding upon his mule, and the mule went under the thick branches of a great oak, and his head caught fast in the oak. He was left hanging between heaven and earth, while the mule that was under him went on. New Testament, Ephesians 4, 25 through 5, 2. Therefore, putting away falsehood, let everyone speak the truth with his neighbor, for we are members of one another. Be angry, but do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger, and give no opportunity to the devil. Let the thief no longer steal, but rather let him labor, doing honest work with his hands, so that he may be able to give to those in need. Let no evil talk come out of your mouths, but only such as is good for edifying, as fits the occasion, that it may impart grace to those who hear. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, in whom we were sealed for the day of redemption. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and slander be put away from you with all malice. And be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, as God in Christ forgave you. Therefore, be imitators of God as beloved children, and walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us, a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. The word of God for the people of God.
Good morning. Good morning. It is good to look out, see you here. Thank you. We move to the prayer concerns. If you look at the back page, we have a list. Please look over that. Are there additional names or perhaps an update someone might want to say? any joy, someone might want to mention. Oh, yes, ma'am. Okay.
I had mentioned we were going to go to Kentucky to see my son, Ryan. We did.
Okay.
He graduated from recruiter school with the military and was promoted to E6.
Oh.
So that's a good ranking for him.
Okay. Okay. Any other joys? Updates? Okay. All right. Let's begin with silent prayer. We thank you, God, that here we are together in this place and that others may be joining us from near or far. We do lift up concerns that have been written, and we are glad to have heard of good news with the military promotion. We come to pray for peace in many places, some far away, peace in Korea, peace in Ukraine, peace in Syria, Israel, Gaza, the West Bank, Lebanon, Yemen. We pray for peace in this country as well. And as we pray for peace in this country, we pray for peace on the campaign trail, that there be no more acts of violence on the campaign trail against anybody running for anything, anywhere in the country. From the highest to the lowest office, that at these meetings, rallies, that they may be peaceful, no violence. We pray for those who struggle for the basics. Pray for those who take care of others. We pray for those who feel that unspoken concerns press down so much upon them. We lift up those who work in the heat. We lift up those who may not have air conditioning at all, that they may have the strength and endurance need. We join together in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power, glory forever. Amen. Okay. As you know, we are not passing the offering plate today, but we are hoping to receive offerings anyway. We have a plate on the table there, and there is a plate on the table over here. If you have already given to that, thank you so much. If you decide to do it right after the service, that's good too. Thank you so much for that. Okay, sorry. Okay. I'm sorry. Stand for the doxology. Sorry about that, everybody.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow.
Our next hymn is number 472. We stand and sing together. We'll continue standing for 472.
There is a place of quiet rest near to the heart of God.
Thank you. Please be seated. I have two scriptures today. The first is Jonah chapter 3, verse 1 to chapter 4, verse 11. That is Jonah chapter 3, verse 1 to chapter 4, verse 11. I begin with Jonah chapter 3, verse 1. Then the word of the Lord came to Jonah the second time, saying, "Arise. Go to Nineveh, that great city, and proclaim to it the message that I will tell you." So Jonah arose and went to Nineveh, according to the word of the Lord. Now Nineveh was an exceedingly great city, 3 days' journey in breadth. Jonah began to go into the city, going a day's journey, and he cried, "Yet 40 days, and Nineveh shall be overthrown." The people of Nineveh believed God. They proclaimed a fast and put on sackcloth from the greatest of them to the least of them. Then tidings reached the king of Nineveh. He arose from his throne, removed his robe, covered himself with sackcloth, and sat in ashes. And he made proclamation and published through Nineveh, "By the decree of the king and his nobles, let neither man nor beast, herd or flock, taste anything. Let them not feed or drink water, but let man and beast be covered by sackcloth. Let them cry mightily to God. Yea, let everyone turn from his evil ways and from the violence which is in his hands. Who knows? God may yet repent and turn from his fierce anger so that we perish not. When God saw what they did, how they turned from their evil way, God repented of the evil that he said he would do to them, and he did not do it. But it displeased Jonah exceedingly, and he was angry. And he prayed to the Lord and said, I pray thee, Lord, is this not what I said when I was yet in my country? That is why I made haste to flee to Tarshish, for I knew thou art a gracious God, a merciful, abounding in steadfast love, and repentest of evil. Therefore now, O Lord, take my life from me, for it is better for me to die than to live. And the Lord said, do you do well to be angry? Then Jonah went out of the city, made a booth for himself there. He sat under in the shade till he could see what would become of the city. And the Lord appointed a plant and made it come up over Jonah that it might be a shade over his head to save him from his discomfort. So Jonah was exceedingly glad because of the plant. But when dawn came up the next day, God appointed a worm which attacked the plant so that it withered. When the sun rose, God appointed a sultry east wind, and the sun beat upon the head of Jonah so that he was faint, and he asked that he might die and said, it is better for me to die than to live. God said to Jonah, do you do well to be angry for the plant? And he said, I do well to be angry, angry enough to die. And the Lord said, you pity the plant for which you did not labor, nor did you make it grow, which came into the world into being in a night and perished in a night. And should I not pity Nineveh, that great city, in which there are more than 100,000 persons who do not know their right hand from their left, and also much cattle? Second passage, New Testament, Matthew chapter 12, verses 38 to 41. I begin with Matthew chapter 12, verse 38. Then some of the scribes and Pharisees said to him, Teacher, we wish to see a sign from you. But he answered them, An evil and adulterous generation seeks for a sign, but no sign shall be given it, except the sign of the prophet Jonah. For as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of the whale, so will the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. The men of Nineveh will arise at the judgment with this generation and condemn it, for they repented at the preaching of Jonah. And behold, something greater than Jonah is here. Now that I've read this, you might think, but be too polite to say it, man, that was a lot of scripture. Two whole chapters and a few additional verses. Wow. New guy. Are you planning on doing this quite often? Probably not. Well, then, why'd you do it today? You're trying to just, I don't know, overwhelm us with scripture? No, that is not the point. It's just that sometimes some of these scriptures are just so good and so interwoven that I thought, okay, we just have to have them in a bunch today, okay? Now, we're looking primarily at Jonah. And there are four chapters of the little book of Jonah. What I've essentially done is read to you chapter 3 and chapter 4. But let's back up and see what happened earlier in the book of Jonah. Now, when we think of Jonah, there are two things that really come to mind. One, we recognize the name. And two, we know somehow, for some reason, he was in the belly of a whale for 3 days and lived through it. Well, it is the name that really sticks in people's minds. He has his own little book in the Old Testament. You might say, well, yeah, but we remember all of them. Not so much. I mean, Obadiah has a book. Haggai has a book. Habakkuk has a book. Nahum has a book. But those names don't stick in our minds as much as Jonah, so his name is really remembered more than several of the other Old Testament worthies. And as for that whole fish thing, well, we'll come back to that. In chapter 1, he receives a mission from God. He was not hoping for one. He was not saying, oh man, if only he had a mission from God. No. I assume it was kind of an ordinary day. I guess he thought he was going to do whatever he planned, or maybe what he did the day before that. But he is hit with this mission from God that he's supposed to leave and go to Nineveh, which is a big enemy city, and preach to them that the God of Israel thinks they have sinned very much, and that he's giving them a limited time to repent, 40 days. Well, he doesn't want to go. I mean, you know, they don't have Jews in that place. They don't have a high opinion of Jews in Nineveh. And they're certainly not known for being interested in the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Moses. So he doesn't want to go. Well, okay, that's a similarity we might have with him, because there are some times that we're kind of unexpectedly dumped with some duty or responsibility. You might say, gee, I really was hoping not to do that. So there's a similarity. But he decides, okay, I need to get away from the presence of the Lord. After all, he's the God of Israel. And if you get out of Israel and go someplace that's not Nineveh, maybe you'll be free. So he on purpose gets on a ship going somewhere else. He knows it's not going in the right direction. That's the whole point. He wants to be away from the presence of God. When he gets on the boat, he falls asleep. And they leave. They're out in the water, and it starts getting very stormy, and it's just worse and worse, and everybody else is freaking out, thinking this ship could sink, which was a very reasonable possibility at the time. They wake him up. I can't believe you're sleeping through all this. If you have some kind of God, just, you know, please call out to him. Maybe he'll save us from this. And he knows what's happened. Now they cast lots, and they realize it's him, and he out and out finally tells them that it's him. And he says, look, okay, what you're going to have to do, you're just going to have to throw me overboard. And they're like, no, we're not doing that, because we're about to die here, and we're not going to have the blood of somebody on our hands right before we die. But it gets so serious that they finally consider, oh, dear Lord God, you have done as you please to do. Do not hold us against us, I paraphrase. And they throw him in the water, and it calms down. All the waves are fairly normal now. The ship is saved, and they're wondering, what happened? And that's where he ends up inside the fish. And then when he is in the fish in chapter 2, he does something he had not done previously. He prays. When he had gotten the mission, he did not say, okay, dear Lord God, I don't want to go on this thing. But if I must, I must. So I pray that you give me the ability to put one foot in front of the other so that I end up in Nineveh and that I do what I'm supposed to do. I'm not too thrilled with it, but help me do it. No, he didn't do that. He saves his prayer mainly for when he's just in such a dire situation. And, you know, sometimes that's what we do. Wait to pray and things get really, really bad. But he does indeed survive. And he is spit up onto the dry land. Okay, great. And then we start with chapter 3, which is what I had read to you. He is told once again to go to Nineveh. This time, no messing around. He goes to Nineveh. And he says the thing that he's supposed to say. And something happened that he did not expect. They believe him. The king believes him. All these other people do. The king puts on sackcloth and ashes, which in the Old Testament is a sign of extreme mourning. Sadness. And he does that, and he tells everybody, put on sackcloth yourself, put it on the animals, everybody stop eating, drinking, whatever you're doing, just stop it. we all have to cry out to the Lord and maybe we'll be spared. And they were spared. Okay? And God decided to change his mind. So they did not get punished the way that they thought they were going to. You might think Jonah would be thinking, this is great, a miracle right in front of my face. Wow. No. He's very angry. What's he so mad about? He didn't like them. He didn't think they should be saved. You know, sometimes you like some people, sometimes you don't. You might say, well, he just got there. I mean, probably doesn't really know anybody at this point. Well, he didn't care. He didn't think they were worthy. And so he tells God, therefore, O Lord, take my life from me, for it's better for me to die than to live. He's just a very emotional guy. He's got these emotions that just kind of can blow up and just possibly even destroy him. That's not always known, but it's there in the scripture. God said, do you do well to be angry? Well, he stomps out of town, and he goes far enough away that if God comes to his senses, in his opinion, and destroys the place, he will be spared. But he stays close enough that he can watch it. So he's out there, and the heat is very, very hot. I mean, you know, the Middle East, for crying out loud. And, trying to pass out. But this plant comes up and gives him shade, and he is so fond of that. And then it dies. He is angry again. Says it is better for me to die than to live. So his emotions still like that. God said, you do well to be angry for the plant. Oh, I do well to be angry. Angry enough to die. And he says, well, you pity the plant which you did not plant and you did not water and you had nothing to do with the creation of it like I did, but you, that's what you care about. That's what you care. And should I not pity Nineveh, that great city, in which there are more than 100,000 persons who do not know their right hand from their left, and also much cattle. Now, the book, the four chapters of the book ends there. We don't know his reaction. He could have said, oh, you put it that way. Yes, I too have sinned, and I too need to repent like they did, yes. Or he could have said, whatever. I mean, really, I don't know why you're letting them off the hook like this. I wouldn't if I was in charge around here. But I don't know how he felt. Don't know. Well, we move to the second passage. And the second passage is Jesus speaking of this generations later. In Matthew chapter 12. Some of the scribes and Pharisees said to Jesus, teacher, we wish to see a sign from you. He answered them, an evil and adulterous generation seeks for a sign, no sign will be given it except the sign of the prophet Jonah. And then verse 40 is an odd verse. I don't remember a verse like this anywhere else, especially in the second part of this verse. For as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of the whale, so the Son of Man, which is Jesus, will be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. That part about the Son of Man being 3 days, three nights in the heart of the earth, that's the only scripture I can think of that has that idea. Then it moves on a bit. The men of Nineveh will arise at the judgment with this generation, the generation that was alive when Jesus was there. And they will condemn it, the generation that was alive when Jesus was there. For they, the people of Nineveh, repented of the preaching of Jonah. Behold, something greater than Jonah is here. And when Jesus is saying something greater than Jonah is here, he is speaking of himself. So when you look at this Jonah thing, it's more than just a famous name. And it's more than just this whole in the belly of the whale. You have somebody who doesn't want to do what he's told to do. Somebody who wants to escape the presence of the Lord. That never works. You can escape from other people. You could go somewhere where you are miles and miles from other people and there is no cell phone reception and you're off the grid, and all of that is possible in certain places. You could. But you can't get away from yourself. And you can't get away from the presence of the Lord. This doesn't work. And he's somebody whose emotions can get the worst of them, which, well, I've struggled with that in my life. But in this story, God is offering mercy to a large group of people who accept it. And he's also trying multiple times to show mercy to this one guy, who's not the most receptive person you're going to meet in town. The people in the city accept it, the wide group. Jonah, we don't know. It could go either way. Well, that's the way it is with us. We think our life is going a certain way, and maybe it is, and maybe it will continue that way, or maybe it won't. We never really know. But in the story, Jesus liked the fact that the people of Nineveh repented. He liked that. And that's a part of the story that is often overlooked. Let's pray. Dear God, sometimes I and we are like Jonah at his worst. Don't want to do what we need to do. Emotions could be very dangerous to us. Could even overcome us. You know. Help us to be more like the people of Nineveh at their best. They did not have a background in you. But they accepted and repented. And may we accept and repent as they did. And not just us, but many others not here among us. Forgive us, strengthen us, strengthen us. In Christ's name we do pray it. Amen. I wanted to end with an optimistic hymn that we would sing with enthusiasm. So let us stand and sing together our final hymn, which is 701. 701. Dress love of Jesus, sing his glory and his name. In the mansions bright and blessed, he'll prepare for us a place. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. While we walk the pilgrim pathway, clouds will overspread the sky. But when traveling days are over, when we all get to heaven, when we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Let us then be true
and faithful, trusting, serving every day. Just one glimpse of Him in glory will the toils of life repay. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Onward to the prize before us, soon His beauty we'll behold. Soon the pearly gates will open, we shall tread the streets of gold. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. Oh, great, good. We all see Jesus, He'll sing and shout the victory.
The benediction is an old favorite of mine, the last couple of verses from the book of Jude. Now to Him who is able to keep you from falling, to present you without blemish before the presence of His glory with rejoicing, the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time and now and forever. Amen. Amen.
Thank you for coming.